I had such a blast. I was so glad to be there. It was beautiful.
Good morning, everyone. Lots of celebration today as we have both a feast day of today being the day of All Saints, All Saints Day. We are also celebrating the liturgy of baptism for one of our own here today. People are still coming in, finding their seats, all that stuff. Give me one moment here, and I will get my instrument and say a few more things, and we'll get started. Those of you who are joining us online, there will be lyrics and all that stuff projected during the service, but if you would like a physical printout of the liturgy, that's available on our website, which is linked in the YouTube description box that you'll find. It's toward the bottom of that. And those of you who are gathered in the building, and if you're visiting with us today, we have not banned singing like some places may have during this uncertain time, but we are limiting it. So if you are comfortable to express your worship in other ways today, whether that's raising your hands, sometimes we have places where we can clap, all those sorts of things, I encourage you to do them. We do have windows open, so you can still feel free to sing if that's what you'd prefer, but I know some people are uncertain about what exactly is the right thing to do. But those are all things that you have available to you. But let's begin our worship together. Please stand and let us sing together for all the saints. For all the saints who from their labors rest, who by faith before the world confess thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Their rock, their fortress, and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain in the well-fought fight. And thou, in the darkness drear, their one true light. Blessed communion, fellowship divine. We feebly struggle, they in glory shine. Yet all are one in thee, for all are thine. But lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on his way. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Worthy is the Lord our God
to receive glory and honor and power.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God.
one Lord, one faith, one baptism.
Let's continue in worship, friends. If this is where you wanted to clap, it'd be,
how rich a treasure we possess in Jesus Christ our Lord. His blood our ransom and defense, his glory our reward.
I hear it.
The sum of all created things are worthless in compare. For our inheritance is him whose praise angels declare. How free and costly was the love displayed upon the cross. While we were dead in untold sin, the sovereign purchased us. The will of God the Father demonstrated through the Son. The Spirit seals the greatest work, the work which Christ has done. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Yours is the kingdom and the power.
How
vast and measureless the flood of mercy unrestrained. The penalty was paid in full, the spotless Lamb was slain. Salvation, what a priceless gift, received by grace through faith. We stand in robes of righteousness, we stand in Jesus' name. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Amen. How rich a treasure we possess in Jesus Christ our Lord. His blood our ransom and defense, his glory our reward.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
The first reading this morning is from the book of Revelation, chapter 7, beginning at verse 9. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these, clothed in white robes, and from where have they come?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to the springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's say the Psalm 149 responsively by half verse. "Praise the Lord. O sing unto the Lord a new song.
Let the congregation of the faithful praise him.
Let Israel rejoice in the one who made him.
And let the children of Zion be joyful in their king.
Let them praise his name in the dance.
Let them sing praises unto him with timbrel and harp.
For the Lord has pleasure in his people.
And gives victory to those who are oppressed.
Let the faithful be joyful with glory.
Let them rejoice upon their beds.
Let the praises of God be in their mouth.
And a two-edged sword in their hands.
To inflict vengeance on the nations.
And to rebuke the peoples.
To bind their kings in chains.
And their nobles with links of iron.
That they may execute judgment upon them, as it is written.
This is the honor of all his servants. Praise the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from Ephesians. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. Far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Please pray with me. Father, we come to hear your word. We come to know your truth. We come to seek the one who makes all things new. Amen.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according
to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
May your word be ever on our minds and on our lips and on our hearts. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. I know I've been preaching out there. My spot is taken up by a big trough this morning, so I'm going to be preaching back here this morning. It's worth it. It's worth it. Trust me. But I want to begin my sermon by rereading a portion of Paul's prayer for the Ephesians from our reading today that Christine read for us. But I want you to hear it as if this is coming from me to you. This prayer sums up much of my own prayer for Christ Our Hope in the 2 months since I've been here. I've heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and so I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints? And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe? It's been my joy in the 2 months that I've been here to celebrate the faith that is evident in this body. And I do pray that you might see, really see, the hope that you have in Christ and the spiritual riches that he has bestowed upon you. Our reading today from the book of Revelation is a beautiful reminder of that hope. The passage comes after 6 judgments have been released upon the earth, and the church has suffered war and famine, deceit and destruction, martyrdom and disasters. Many who were faithful to Christ have died in those troubles. But here we see what awaits them. The saints who passed through these trials found the same thing as those of every age before them. God the Father and Jesus Christ are waiting to receive them. And in their presence, they find themselves in a place where his kingdom is fully manifest, where his will is done perfectly at all times. We pray for that every week. Your kingdom come, your will be done. And here they get to see it, where there is no more war, but instead a beautiful unity of every nation and tribe and people and tongue joined in praise to the Father and the Son, where there is no more hunger or thirst ever again. No destruction shall touch them, for they are under the shepherding hand of the Lamb. And this is a vision that we need to see. We need to remember that peace awaits all who die in Christ and is already experienced by those saints who have gone before us. But I think even more importantly in this day and age, we need to remember that Jesus reigns. His rule is not some abstract fact for a far-off future. It is a present reality which we see and experience only in part, but is no less real for that. In the book of Revelation, the veil is pulled back for a moment, and we get a glimpse into the throne room of God, and we receive an invitation to join the saints in eternal praise and to live now with an unshakable faith in the reign of our God. Paul had that kind of faith as he wrote to the Ephesians about the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, even though he was writing from a prison cell instead of God's throne room. Neither his own circumstances nor the persecution of the early church could shake his belief in the present and eternal reign of Jesus Christ. How could he have such confidence that Jesus is far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come, in the middle of the trials that he and the church faced? How can we look around at our own world and have such confidence? Clearly, we don't get that confidence by looking around and deciding that things are going pretty well, so God must be in charge. If our faith and our hope is rooted in our circumstances, it will never endure the sort of trials imagined in Revelation or the suffering promised by Jesus. It might not even endure past this week's election. Our hope is not in the circumstances, though. But neither are we supposed to stick our heads in the sand and live in denial of the difficulties and challenges we face. In verses 19 and 20, Paul tells us where to look for our confidence in God's reign. He hopes that we know the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. Two real historical events, attested by many witnesses, serve as the linchpin for our faith and for our hope: the resurrection and the ascension. Because this is the mystery of our faith that we proclaim every single week when we're here celebrating at the table, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. In the resurrection, we have evidence that God's kingdom is breaking into this world and no power can stop it. This is echoed in the praises of the saints in Revelation. They were faithful unto death and still found Christ's reign secure. But it's important to note that while the resurrection undergirds our greatest hope, and we know that even death cannot separate us from the love of Christ, we're also not looking to death as just an escape from our circumstances. Our hope is also not for some abstract, far-off future. It's not for when we can escape this world and get to another place where things are, where the circumstances are improved. The Christian hope is not merely for one day that we're going to get out of the mess, leave it behind, and then everything will be all right. Paul wanted the Ephesians and us to know that the greatness of God's power is evident here in the present day. And this is one of the reasons why he points not just to the resurrection, but to the ascension. In the ascension, we believe that Jesus has gone to take his place at the Father's right hand now. He is there. Jesus reigns. Jesus is Lord, not at some point in the future. Not Jesus will reign when he returns. Jesus reigns now. As Paul puts it, God has seated him at this right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. This is a present, enduring reality. And we have to keep our eyes on the fact that Jesus is Lord. Jesus reigns now, and our hope is now because of what he has done for us. Nothing that has happened this year or any other year has taken God off guard. No tragedy or travesty has come about because God's plans have been thwarted. Somehow, all of our present losses and hurts and sufferings are yet part of God's perfect plan. We cannot see how exactly, and there are days and moments, I'm sure, where it doesn't seem possible that somehow all of this can be worked into God's plan. But the resurrection doesn't seem possible if we just take it at face value. But it's true. It happened. God's power was made evident in raising Jesus Christ from the dead, and our hope is secure. The power of God is not limited to what seems possible to us. And one day we will find it works backwards on the hurts that we have suffered and brings about a joy that is greater joy for having walked through the sorrows that we suffer now. One of my favorite pictures of this is in the book Lord of the Rings, or I suppose also the movie, if that's your thing. I'm more of a book person. Near the end of the final volume of the book, in The Return of the King, Sam and Frodo have exhausted themselves utterly in their quest to destroy the ring. They've been walking that long path. They have given their very last bit of energy. They take their very tiny last bit of whatever they have to walk out of the volcano where they have cast the ring. They've completed the quest, and they're just trying to find a place to die. They have no hope. They knew from the beginning that it was a mission that would take them into death. And they collapse exhausted on the side of Mount Doom. But what they don't know is that with Sauron's power broken when the ring was destroyed, the eagles are now able to fly into Mordor and rescue them. They faint as that rescue comes, and Sam awakes to find Gandalf, who the last time he saw him had died, alive, next to him, looking down upon him. And he delivers this famous line, "Gandalf, I thought you were dead, but then I thought I was dead myself. Is every sad thing going to come untrue? What's happened to the world?" And the answer, of course, is yes. We look to Jesus as well and we say, "I thought I was dead, but then again, I thought you were dead too. And is every sad thing going to come untrue?" Yes, every sad thing is going to come untrue. For those who are in Christ, one day every sad thing is going to come untrue. This is a beautiful story with a happy ending. And no matter how many times I consider both Sam and Frodo, their plight, and then consider the gospel and what this is actually saying to us about the nature of the gospel, I feel moved to tears almost every time that I tell the story. But there's one more question that I find sometimes troubles my own heart, and probably sometimes troubles yours, which is, this is a great story, a beautiful story. I want to believe this story, but do I really have a place in it? Because it's one thing to believe that God reigns now and forever in some sort of abstract sense. It's another thing altogether to believe that he will one day set things right. And yet, I think it's an even harder belief, an even greater step of faith sometimes, to believe that when God sets things right, that I will be there, that you will be there. That in your particular story, with your particular sorrows and struggles and sins, every sad thing is going to come untrue. This is one of the reasons that God gives us the Holy Spirit. Walking back further into that Ephesians passage in verses 13 and 14, he says, "In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. The Holy Spirit, who was given to you when you believe the gospel, is the promise that God's word comes true. In him, he has already united you with Jesus in his death and resurrection. In him, he has already begun to mark you as holy, set apart, and to prepare you for the eternal kingdom where he does have a place for you. Because you have the Spirit of God, you also have an enduring eternal hope. And make no mistake, if you believe that Jesus is Lord, that God has indeed raised him from the dead, you have repented and turned to him, then you have done so by the gift of the Holy Spirit. There are times where that gift is easier to feel. There are times where it is more visibly evident. But 1 Corinthians 12:3 says, no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. The very fact that these mysteries have been unveiled to us tells us that God intends for us to participate in them. But God also knows that we at times need a tangible reminder that we are part of his kingdom. God knows that we are physical beings. He has made us with bodies, and we need to touch and feel and see things with our own eyes. And he's given us sacraments to help us with that. This is one of the reasons that we're celebrating a baptism today. Baptism is the initiation rite of the church. In just a few minutes, when I baptize Rain and Lily Sides, we're saying that we recognize them as part of this family, the family of God's people, the church. We are giving them a moment that they can look back on forever to remember who they are. Those who have been set apart for God, who have been united with Christ in his death and in his resurrection. And they have a place now and forever in his kingdom. We do this in response to faith, because it is by faith we have been saved. Rain, who is a little older, will proclaim her own faith. Trevor and Lindsay are going to make a pledge of faith on behalf of Lily. We hope and expect that one day Lily will claim that for her own. But we baptize her now because she's already part of this family, part of the people in whom Jesus is working out his purposes for all things. And when we baptize these children, we'll also have a chance to renew and remember our own baptismal vows. Remember that we too are part of this family, this people in whom God has said that he is working out his purposes. Because whether you were baptized as an adult or whether you were baptized as a child, if you are here now, it is a sign of God's purposes being worked out in you. Listen to the final verses of the Ephesians passage that we read today, as Eugene Peterson translates them in the Message. I think this is a particularly beautiful rendering of this particular passage. All this energy issues from Christ. God raised him from death and set him on a throne in deep heaven, in charge of running the universe, everything from galaxies to governments. No name and no power exempt from his rule. And not just for the time being, but forever. He's in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body, in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence. So as we move into baptism, and continue to proclaim the gospel in the liturgy of baptism, remember this. You, if you are a baptized Christian, are part of the church. And the church is at the very center of God's purposes. Because of this, you can have confidence that God is working out his purposes in you and through you, that his kingdom will reign now and forever, and you have a place in it. This is the hope that we rest on. Let's join together in this hope in baptism.
You can all remain seated, but as we prepare to celebrate the Liturgy of Baptism, let's sing this Taizé together.
There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There is one God who is Father of all. There is one body, there is one Spirit, there is one hope to which we are called. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There is one God who is Father of all. There is one body, there is one Spirit, there is one hope to which we are called. There is one one faith, one baptism. There is one God who is Father of all. There is one body, there is one Spirit, there is one hope to which we are.
Rain and Lillian, Trevor and Lindsay, I invite you to come up. Dearly beloved, Scripture teaches us that we were all dead in our sins and trespasses, but by grace we may be saved through faith. Our Savior Jesus Christ said, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." And he commissioned the church to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Here we ask our Heavenly Father that these candidates, being baptized with water, may be filled with the Holy Spirit, born again, and received into the church as living members of Christ's body. Therefore, I urge you to call upon God the Father, through our Lord Jesus Christ, that of his abundant mercy he will grant to these candidates that which by nature they cannot have. The candidates for holy baptism will now be presented.
We present Rain Sides to receive the sacrament of baptism.
Rain, have you already been baptized?
No.
Do you desire to be baptized? Go ahead. Today, on behalf of this child, you shall make vows to renounce the devil and all his works, to trust God wholeheartedly, and to serve him faithfully. It is your task to see that this child is taught, as soon as she is able to learn, the meaning of all these vows, and of the faith that you will profess as revealed in the Holy Scriptures. She must come to put her faith in Jesus Christ and learn the creeds, the Lord's Prayer, the Ten Commandments, and all other things that a Christian ought to know, believe, and do for the welfare of her soul. When she has embraced all these, she is to come to the bishop to be confirmed, that she may publicly claim the faith for her own and be further strengthened by the Holy Spirit to serve Christ and her kingdom. Are you willing and ready to undertake this?
I am. Lord, be my helper.
And now I'm going to ask these questions for the sides to answer. Do you renounce the devil and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the empty promises and deadly deceits of this world that corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the sinful desires of the flesh that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
For everyone else, I did make sure that Lily renounced all these things when she was not up in front of a large crowd of people, so... Almighty God, deliver you from the powers of darkness and evil, and lead you into the light and obedience of the kingdom of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and confess him as your Lord and Savior? Do you joyfully receive the Christian faith as revealed in the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments?
I do.
Will you obediently keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in them all the days of your life? Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
We will.
Let us join with these candidates to proclaim our faith in the words of the ancient baptismal confession, the Apostles' Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I do. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe and trust in Jesus Christ?
I do.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I do.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now pray for these candidates who are to receive the sacrament of baptism.
These children may come to confess their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That all these candidates may continue in the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayer.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord. We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That they persevere in resisting evil, and whenever they fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That they may proclaim by word and deed the good news of God in Christ Jesus to a lost and broken world.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord. Beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That looking to Jesus, they may run with endurance the race set before them, and at the last receive the unfading crown of glory.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord. Take a moment to continue to pray for Rain and Lily, and if you have any prayers to speak out loud, feel free to do so right now. God, we thank you for your great love made evident to us in adoption of us into your family, that each of us may remember that we are brought into your family by your choice and love. I pray that Rain and Lily will be, in particular, be models for us in that, remembering their own love and their adoption both into the Sides family and into this family, that we may all grow in faith and hope and love together as the church. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, in your great mercy you saved Noah and his family in the ark from the destruction of the flood, prefiguring the sacrament of holy baptism. Look mercifully upon these your servants. Wash and sanctify them through your Holy Spirit, that they may be delivered from destruction and received into the ark of Christ's church, and being steadfast in faith, joyful through hope, and rooted in love, that they may pass through the turbulent floods of this troublesome world and come into the land of everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your Son Jesus received the baptism of John in the River Jordan when the Holy Spirit descended upon him as a dove. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are made regenerate by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now, Father, sanctify this water by the power of your Holy Spirit. May all who are baptized here be cleansed from sin, be born again, and continue forever faithful in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
That's great, yeah. Well, this is going to be lots of fun. You get to get like wet in your clothes in a building. Lily, come here and stand in it with me.
Oh,
come here.
Come on, baby.
Come on. Pour water on their heads.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we're not gonna get in the tub.
baptize you in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to sit down, and I'm going to put you all the way in the water, okay? Lily? So lay back, and I'm going to put you under, hold your breath, and I'm going to pull you right back up, okay? Boop. One, two, three, boop.
Yeah.
Lily, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Receive the sign of the cross as a token of your new life in Christ, in which you shall not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified, and to bravely under his banner against the world, the flesh, and the devil. Fight bravely under his banner against the world, the flesh, and the devil, and to continue in his faithful soldier, as his faithful soldier and servant to the end of your days. Amen. Lily, receive the sign of the cross as a token of your new life in Christ, in which you shall not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified, to fight bravely under his banner against the world, the flesh, and the devil, and to continue as his faithful soldier and servant to the end of your days. Amen.
Amen.
Let us welcome the newly baptized. Receive you into the fellowship of the church. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection and share with us in the royal priesthood of all his people. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Greet one another with a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace of Christ to you. 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 Peace, James. Got just a couple of very quick announcements here. If you didn't notice it when you came in, there is the table that is set out there. Today is the Feast of All Saints Day, and we remember those saints who have died and are with Christ already. And we had the giving for the fires in Colorado that we had giving through our church webpage. If you are giving there, if you'd like to give there, please do so. We'll probably take that down at some point so that it doesn't stay up forever. So please go ahead and do that. And then we'll enter into
into the offering right now.
Yeah, and worth mentioning that, again, if you're joining us online, we have a link in that same YouTube description box for our online giving platform that does have that. You can switch between general giving and the Cameron Peak Fire Relief Fund if that's where you'd prefer your monies go. But yeah, as we enter into our time of offering, as always, we do welcome those offerings online. And there's a basket right outside that Christine's showing right there. If you'd prefer to give physically, we do collect that at the end of the service. But here's our sermon response hymn, Holy God, We Praise Thy Name.
Holy God, we praise thy name. Lord of all, we bow before thee. All on earth thy scepter claim. All in heaven above adore thee. Infinite thy vast domain, everlasting is thy reign. Hark the glad celestial hymn, angel choirs above are raising, cherubim and seraphim in unceasing chorus praising, fill the heavens with sweet accord. Holy, holy, holy Lord. Lo, the apostolic train joins thy sacred name to hallow, the prophets swell the glad refrain, and the white-robed martyrs follow, and from morn to set of sun, through the church the song goes on.
Please stand for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
You.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
For in the multitude, it is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For in the multitude of your saints, you have surrounded us with so great a cloud of witnesses that we, rejoicing in their fellowship, may run with patience the race that is set before us, and together with them may receive the unfading crown of glory. And therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. The Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. And sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed once for all upon the cross.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
We do not, pray with me, please. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. Apart from your grace, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through by his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
We'll dismiss row by row, and then you can just go back to your seat along this side aisle, just so that we don't have traffic going back and forth in this middle aisle. We do have the offering basket up here if you'd like to place your offering before you return to your seat. Please be seated.
Just a reminder, we are doing communion in one kind. Still, so I will pass out the bread to you, and this is the Lord's table, not an Anglican table, so we welcome all baptized Christians to participate in the sacrament.
Oh, that I could see your face. How I'm longing for that day. Brighter sun of holy grace, make my heart a holy place. Blessed are the poor who have nothing to own. Blessed are the mourners who are crying alone. Blessed are the guilty who have nowhere to go, for their hearts have a road to the kingdom of God, and their souls are the songs of the kingdom of God, and they will find a refuge, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Beauty shining from your face, always long to see this place. Is there somewhere I can stay, even just a couple days? Blessed are the poor who have nothing to own. Blessed are the mourners who are crying alone. Blessed are the guilty who have nowhere to go, for their hearts have a road to the kingdom of God, and their souls are the songs of the kingdom of God, and they will find a refuge, for theirs is the kingdom of God. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. In valley or pasture, we shall not want. Our cup runneth over and over again, for now and forever, for now and forever. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. In valley or pasture, we shall not want. Our cup runneth over and over, for now and forever, for now and forever. Blessed are the poor who have nothing to own. Blessed are the mourners who are crying alone. Blessed are the guilty, nowhere to go, for their hearts are the souls of the kingdom of God, and they will find a refuge, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Jesus said, let the children come to me, I have time. Let them climb upon my knee. No one comes to the Father but by me. So let the children come to me. A simple thing, Sprinkled water, spoken word, heaven sings. Although no earthly sound is heard, one more child of my Father's come to me. Let the children come to me and preach my word to every nation and testify to all I've done and teach the ways that I reach out to them and let the children come to me. Let the children come to me.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. All of our problems of this life on earth, we send to the cross of Christ. All the difficulties of our circumstances, we send to the cross of Christ. All the devil's works from his temporary power, we send to the cross of Christ. All our hopes for wholeness and eternal life, we set on the risen Christ. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
All right, this is another one where I encourage clapping if you find the rhythm. Here we go. Oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in, oh, on that hallelujah day, oh, on that hallelujah day, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number on that hallelujah day. Oh, when the trumpet sounds the call, oh, when the trumpet sounds the call, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when the trumpet sounds the call. Oh, when they crown him Lord of Lords, oh, when they crown him Lord of Lords, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when they crown him Lord of Lords. When the saints, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in.
Their celebration, I got a request for an extra hallelujah at the end here. So when we do our dismissal here, let's go for an extra three hallelujahs at the end. Hallelujah, hallelujah, let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
And amen.
Now we know why the church is sprinkling.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, I figure if you can't come to the idea of death and resurrection with a little bit of fear and trembling, then you probably haven't quite understood it anyway. So, yeah. So, we learned something too in the way the children approach it. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'm Jeremy.